Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and thank you again for your patience as we just waited for all of our participants to be ready tonight for this really exciting program. I'm John Jablonski, president of Clinton Community College. On behalf of the students, faculty, staff, board of trustees, and our chair, Nina Coolidge, who is here tonight, it's my pleasure to welcome you to Clinton, which was recently ranked by Washington Monthly as one of the best community colleges in the nation. So we're delighted to host this event tonight. On behalf of our sponsors, and I'll list them here, the Nelson A. Rockefeller Institute of Government, the North Country Regional Economic Development Council, the North Country Chamber of Commerce, the Development Corporation, SciTech, and Mountain Lake PBS, and on behalf of our guest speakers and our distinguished panel of experts who will be formally introduced in just a moment, I thank you for participating in tonight's community forum on universities and colleges as economic drivers. Tonight's forum is the first of four that will be held around the state this fall. The others will be held in Albany, Potsdam, Buffalo in the coming weeks. It's an honor for this community, Plattsburgh, New York, to be the first in the state to illustrate how the broader theme of tonight's forum applies to our own local region. Specifically tonight, we will focus on how two colleges, SUNY Plattsburgh and Clinton Community College, have worked with our partners to help Plattsburgh to become Montreal's U.S. suburb. Before I turn the rest of the program over to our moderator, it is my honor to read aloud an open letter from SUNY Chancellor Nancy Zimpfer, who is away at another event out of state today, and I will read on her behalf the following, addressed to all of you. To our academic and business leaders, it is with great pleasure that I welcome you to today's forum entitled Universities and Colleges as Economic Drivers. I very much wish that my schedule allowed me to be there in person for this event. I have so much enjoyed the time I've spent in your beautiful city on the shores of Lake Champlain, and I'm always happy to return, especially for so important and exciting reason as tonight's discussion. When I arrived at SUNY nearly 5 years ago, right after the Great Recession of 2008, I toured all 64 campuses of our system. I came away from that tour convinced that higher education was the key to revitalizing the state's economy. We developed a strategic plan called the Power of SUNY that laid the groundwork to position SUNY as New York's economic driver. As part of that effort, we engaged in a series of scholarly conversations to study and discuss the various ways which all colleges and universities, public and private, two-year and four-year, contribute to the economic vitality of their communities. This forum, one in a series conceived by SUNY's public policy think tank, the Nelson A. Rockefeller Institute of Government, is an extension of that work. This forum is based on a book edited by Jason Lane, professor and academic leader at SUNY, and by former SUNY Chancellor D. Bruce Johnstone. As I said in the foreword of the book, SUNY, with its ubiquitous presence throughout the state, coupled with its innate power to educate the future workforce, as well as serve as a creator of new knowledge and jobs, is uniquely positioned to be the economic engine that New York State needs. In the spirit of partnership, I am thrilled that today's event was put together in concert with your regional campus administrations and economic development agencies. For their support of this idea, we are truly grateful. I'm delighted that you are here tonight for what we hope will be the first of many dialogues designed to enhance collaboration among our great state's colleges, businesses, and the government in order to bolster the economic vitality of the North Country and the entire Empire State. Sincerely, Nancy L. Zimpfer, Chancellor. Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to begin our program. Let me remind you that the program will conclude about 6:30, maybe a little bit late because we're starting late. And afterwards, as Thom Hallock said, we invite you to stay for the reception and some sustenance in gratitude for your patience. Without further ado, I turn the floor over to our moderator for this evening, Thom Hallock, the anchor for Mountain Lake Journal from Mountain Lake PBS. Thom Hallock.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. It is an absolute pleasure to be here, and thank you for attending tonight. We are going to begin by inviting one of our featured guests tonight to come up and say a few words. Ken Adams is the President and CEO of Empire State Development and Commissioner of the New York State Department of Economic Development. Mr. Adams, of course, is familiar to many of you folks. His years leading the Business Council of New York State. It is the state's leading business association. He served as the president and CEO from 2006 to 2011. It is a pleasure to have him back in the Plattsburgh area. Ken Adams.
Thank you, Thom. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I was asked to share some opening thoughts with you all tonight, and I'm delighted to do that. Is Nancy's picture still up there? It is. Yeah. Well, she's a good friend, and this is a topic that she and I have discussed at length many times, and so maybe having her watch over me, it'll keep me honest. A big thanks to the Chancellor, of course, and to Roseanne Murphy, who I think all of you know, who runs our ESD office here, for really covering vast stretches of the North Country, but based here in Plattsburgh. And to my longtime friend, Gary Douglas, who is always part of whatever ESD is doing and the Regional Council is up to. And if you see me in the room, Gary has had a hand in it. And I'm grateful to him for that. Now, just a couple of brief observations, and then obviously Thom will introduce the panel and they'll begin the discussion. And I'm going to take a front row seat and pay close attention to the talk tonight. But I was asked to mention a couple of things, and I wanted to start by reflecting on something that is really important to the governor, something we're working on that has led to a new program, which I do want to mention briefly, the new Startup New York program, sort of the genesis of that. And as we look at the work of all 10 of our regional councils, not just this great North Country Regional Council, but all 10 of them across the state, a common theme. And that's this notion, again, the driving idea here tonight about economic development done in partnership and collaboration with higher education institutions. And when I say that, of course, I mean two-year community colleges, four-year schools, private schools, SUNY schools, research universities, that whole wealth of really incredible institutions we have all across the state as partners for economic development. And the thinking sort of goes like this. Remember that what we do at ESD in terms of attracting new investment to the state, we do it in a very competitive climate, in the sense that we're one of 50 other states, obviously, and one of many developed nations. And when we seek investment from abroad or from other states, we're always in competition with these other jurisdictions. And so the first thought is, and I can just tell you this from personal experience serving as the Commissioner of Economic Development for the governor, time and again, we increasingly see that our edge, our advantage in New York is the quality of our workforce, and that, of course, is driven by the quality of our higher education institutions. And I don't mean that at all kind of lightly. I think that what is essential moving forward is an acceleration of the partnerships and the collaborations you're going to hear about tonight all across the state, with the view that this is really part of creating, over time, a globally competitive workforce for New York State that becomes a distinguishing characteristic of our state. You know, there are plenty of obstacles, everyone in the room knows, to doing business in New York, but there are also plenty of advantages. And one of the advantages, certainly in an age of technologically driven economic development, of things like advanced manufacturing, of the knowledge economy, if you will, one of the advantages New York has against other states is the quality of our workforce. But again, that's driven by the quality of our education system. It's really, they're one and the same. And so you back away to sort of an overview of our education system, of our higher education system, and I think there's really something quite phenomenal. And again, I talk about this a lot all over the place, including outside the state when we're working with other companies. And it's the infrastructure that we have to build on in higher education. By that I mean, if you think about 65 SUNY campuses, 29 CUNY campuses in the city system, 220 private independent colleges and universities, that if you think about the geographic distribution by design since the 1950s of the SUNY system, and then the more county-affiliated two-year community colleges, if you think about the even the setup of the CUNY system, and then for a host of other reasons, perhaps more historic and anecdotal, but the geographic distribution of the private and independent colleges and universities, and you put that all across, you put that all across a map of the state, it actually, and you start to connect the dots, like literally, you get this incredible foundation upon which you can really build a knowledge economy, upon which you can really develop a globally competitive workforce. And I would argue, if you think about how other state systems work, so many public systems in other states are actually, and they're great systems in many states, but they're highly concentrated, you know, with large marquee campuses, often in the state capital or in big cities. Think of the California system or Michigan or Wisconsin or pick your state. What you don't have is that great mix of public and private institutions with that geographic distribution. And in the case of New York, that distribution is laid out over a big and broad and diverse economy. So here's where the partnerships part come in. Think about the scope of our economy. It's a 1.1, it's actually $1.2 trillion economy in terms of gross state product. By that, I mean if New York were, for some reason, an independent and sovereign nation, we'd have the 15th largest economy in the world. We have a private sector workforce of 7.5 million people are in the private sector workforce. And the diversity of that economy, that trillion-dollar economy, in terms of industries, and then in terms of the needs of those industries, the sectors and the subsectors, is, again, like no other state. So having the distribution of that economy and all of the different regional variances that the governor's regional council system has made clear, regional priorities, regional strength, regional assets, having that as the economy, and then underneath it, this vast and so well kind of distributed and built infrastructure of higher education institutions, you see where I'm going. That's a platform for economic development. I mean, that's really a foundation. And someone was asking me before the program started, if these individual partnerships, like those here at Clinton Community College, and you know, you can keep going around the state and look at individual success stories, if they're so good, you know, what do we do to have more of them? How do we advance more of this collaboration? And that's where the governor has developed this program, Startup New York, which I referenced just a couple of minutes ago. And I think as people become more and more familiar with Startup New York, it'll become evident that this new economic development tool, which is really the new marquee program the governor's advancing just now as we speak across the state, created by legislation passed into law with the support of the legislature back in June. But Startup New York as a new economic development tool is that tool that will accelerate these partnerships because it creates something we never had before. Again, given the infrastructure I just described and given the economy I loosely described, think now about this new program, this incentive program, which basically says to every one of those schools, each one of them, two-year school, four-year college, research institution, has the opportunity to identify a block of space on campus or off campus and have it designated as a startup or tax-free zone, meaning companies that qualify and come into that campus-owned or controlled space can have a 10-year abatement from all New York State imposed taxes. I think most of you are familiar with the program, but think about that. That's a little bit like saying for 10 years here, if we just use an example of Clinton Community College, a startup zone could be created. It would be certified through us at ESD. Companies coming into it would have, for up to 10 years, no state tax liability, no income taxes for the workers, no corporate business tax, no franchise fees, no property tax, because they're obviously on nonprofit property already. But the point is, it's a tax incentive or tax abatement program that we've never had before, and that only works if the company is partnering with the school. In fact, one of the kind of qualifiers here is has to be a new company moving into the state, or a startup generated from the intellectual property, the discovery, the innovation coming out of that particular school. And it can also be an affiliate, if it's a new company, of an existing New York State company that creates a partnership with a school to do something new. So imagine GE or you know, IBM or you know, pick an iconic New York State company, Corning down in the Southern Tier, that is thinking about locating a new function, a new division, a new technology anywhere around the world. And they're looking at Texas or Florida in the States because of their friendly tax regimes, or at other countries for whatever reason. All of a sudden, they can give New York a second look if they partner with a school, a SUNY, or a private or independent in one of those in one of those startup zones. So what this program does is it says, first and foremost, the schools have an opportunity to create one of these economic development, these startup zones on campus, or again, an incubator. There's a variety of ways to do it. But then it only works if the companies applying have a connection to the curriculum, to what's going on in the classroom or the laboratory. There are a variety of ways to do that. But the school sort of declares a mission, and then the companies are matched to that mission. And what's that lead to? Anything from actual direct research that's happening between the company and the school at the faculty level, to jobs for students, internships, co-op programs, other summer other things for students to get engaged in the company. And I was telling somebody this the other day. One of the things I think is remarkable, and you know, we're just preparing now the applications, in case you're curious, for schools to start applying to identify their startup space and then get it certified. And then the second step is we'll all work together to identify these companies. Now, the theme of tonight is Plattsburgh is a southern suburb of Montreal. You know, Gary already has a list of all these companies. They're going to come from Montreal and open up on startup space in the North Country, affiliated with schools like Clinton Community College. But the point is, another thing in terms of, the appeal of this program in terms of even strengthening the educational pipeline. Think about, you have to sort of now, I mean, I'm describing a program that doesn't take effect till January 1 next year. But think a little more long term. You know, think about this program 5-10 years down the road. And think about all of the schools that will have created these startup zones and will have brought companies to the zones or nurtured local talent into a startup in the zone. And think about what that means to the high school kid thinking about going to school. When all of a sudden on the tour of the campus, if he or she takes one, you see the classrooms, you see the labs, and then you see the company right there. And you see the real, what's happening? How's what's going on in the classroom actually translating into a business opportunity where maybe the people are graduates now and they're people running the company. But you see it right there on the campus. And doesn't that become a more compelling, even just in the college admissions process, doesn't that become a more compelling argument for schools to say that they're actually got companies and space and startups and everything they're doing in the classroom has this real-world application, and yes, it leads to careers, and look, you can see it and be part of it if you come to this school. And inasmuch as higher education for New York State is part of our export economy, and it is, the great number of students from other states and countries that come to the schools I described at the beginning, you think about that's a very powerful part, actually, of our export product. If you don't believe me, ask Laura Anglin, who runs KIKU, the Council of Independent and Colleges and Universities, and she's got a study that will tell you that just the private universities and colleges in the state generate over, I think it's about $60 billion in economic activity every year. And again, think of that in terms of all the students coming in from out of state. That's the equivalent of export activity. So think of the degree to which, again, you've got to play this out into the future. These collaborations we're talking about tonight happening all systematically on campuses throughout the SUNY system, and throughout private and independent colleges and universities across the state, this incentive program brings everybody together and in a good competitive way gets people to, as I say, accelerate this, form these partnerships, attract these companies, engage professors and researchers, faculty administrators and students, and so that over time you've built out, you've taken this foundation I described and built on it these partnerships with these companies that's driving private investment and private sector job growth. So from collaborations that the North Country is pioneering that I suspect folks on the panel will talk about, including some that were recently submitted in this year's CFA funding round, for, you know, competitive process for funding that are being evaluated right now. So in those local examples, I just wanted to say with this new program, Startup New York, think about how that can be extended and expanded all across the state and what it means for really doing, again, collaborations between higher education and business, or for the purposes of technology-driven economic development. But think about doing that at scale, doing that at scale. You know, and part of the law here, the startup law, limits the private and independent colleges and universities in terms of how much space they can designate. So someone says, well, you know, what's that about? It's limited to 3 million square feet. That's plenty of space. Someone said, well, what if, you know, Cornell takes it all? They won't take it all. That's not going to happen. But think of that played out. Actually, all of the space available in the system, including the space available through the SUNY system and the CUNY system, is over 100 million square feet. So there's a remarkable potential to build on that infrastructure. But all of these examples, campus by campus across the system, will be examples of partnerships between higher education institutions and business, and again, will lead to economic development for the state, new investment and new jobs because of those collaborations. And at the end of the day, as I said before, put us in an even better competitive position when it comes to attracting students, researchers, and yes, businesses and investors to New York. So it's a powerful new tool, but it's driven by this, by the exact topic that you're talking about tonight, and by the governor's sort of keen sensitivity to the role higher education plays in economic development and his desire to leverage that foundation that I described. So again, thank you for letting me share this little overview with you. I'll stick around in case there are questions that I can help answer later, and I'll certainly, on a more sort of friendly and social note, look forward to the reception where we can catch up and talk more one-on-one. But thanks again for the opportunity, and I look forward to the panel. Thanks. First, Thom. There he is.
All right. Thank you, Ken. Thank you very much. So Ken will be around for the reception, and also when we take questions at the end, he'll be right here so he can come up and answer any questions that you may have. It's now my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker tonight, our featured speaker. Dr. Jason Lane is Deputy Director for Research at the Nelson A. Rockefeller Institute of Government in Albany. He is also an Associate Professor of Education Administration and Policy Studies at the University of Albany. And the reason he is joining us tonight, Jason is also the author and co-editor of a new book, Universities and Colleges as Economic Engines, which he is here to talk about tonight. Please welcome Jason Lane.
Well, good evening, everybody. Let's get Nancy's picture off. We'll move on to get her away from us a little bit. But let me say first, thank you for having me. It's an absolute delight to be here. I'm thrilled that we're kicking off this series of forums here in Plattsburgh because I think there are some really exciting things happening here because of the colleges and universities here, John Etling and John Jablonski and Gary Douglas, in terms of really trying to think about how do we create partnerships between the business and the universities. And a lot of that's being facilitated for all the things that Ken Adams just talked about in terms of the government providing the policy structure to make that really happen and make that effective. In fact, I think I'm going to sit down right now because Ken pretty much said everything I'm going to at this point in time. So I'm actually delighted to be here because of what was just said is what we've been talking about in this book for a long time, and that is trying to raise awareness of the real value of college and universities in the communities where they exist, and that they are critical drivers for economic development for their communities and for the states, because we are in a new era of competition. And I like to talk about, and to start my talks with this quote from Clark Kerr. Clark Kerr is probably one of the more legendary presidents, university presidents of the last century. He was the head of the University of California system for a period of time in the 1960s. And he said way back in 1963, "We are just now perceiving that the university's invisible product, that is knowledge, may be the most powerful single element in our culture, affecting the rise and fall of professions and even social classes or regions and even nations." And in fact, this is what Ken was just talking about in terms of the competition for jobs, that there's such intense competition out there right now for jobs and for economic development that universities are becoming key players in this whole thing because countries recognize that the U.S. built its strength up on its universities, because the universities were the ones that were developing the research and the innovation that was driving this economy. It was the universities that were attracting the best and brightest brains from around the world to come here and invent things and be the innovators and be the entrepreneurs and create the companies that now exist in our country that end up employing so many of the people in our workforce. So much so now, it's created a competition. Well, actually, let me do this first. Think about this. This was the knowledge that was in place in 1963. Just so we think about how much things have changed, right? In fact, the zip code was just coming into creation about that time, which I think is pretty interesting. You can see the satellites, you can see the computers, and this is where we are today. How far have we advanced? The iPad, that thing up there is a fan, by the way. That little circle thing. It's pretty amazing to think about it. And of course, email. We've come a long way from zip codes now that we now have email going on. So many of these advancements were put forward from universities, from colleges, from people who are college educated. And it's created now what is called the Great Brain Race. Around the world, there's competition for higher education because higher ed has become one of the most valuable commodities in the world because national leaders have recognized that it is colleges and universities that are driving their economic development. In fact, we now even have competition over competition. There is a global competitiveness index that ranks the competitive level of each country in terms of their ability to attract jobs and businesses from around the world. And much of the index is based on the nation's higher education system. Because they realize the next great economy is going to be driven by innovation. And that innovation is going to create new businesses and is going to create new jobs, and that's going to attract more people to that country and more money to that country, and they know innovation is coming from higher ed. But it's more than a global competition, it's also local, right? One of the themes of the book that we talk about is that colleges and universities are anchor institutions. What do I mean by that? Well, when all the business and industries leave a town, what's left? The college. Through good times and bad, what is there? The college. It continues to exist. It is the critical employer of communities. It is the critical bringer of new people to communities. It is community vitality. It is keeping our communities alive. So that when business and industry leave, we continue to have our colleges there. And we did a report at the Rockefeller Institute called A New Paradigm for Economic Development, where we really launched this idea forward saying, let's embrace higher ed as an economic driver. And this quote is from that. It said, from Springfield, Massachusetts, where a technical college has converted an abandoned factory into an urban tech park, to Raleigh-Durham, North Carolina, where research universities work to turn a sleepy backwater into a global powerhouse of innovation and manufacturing, to Sydney, Nebraska, where a community college operates a training academy that has helped keep the headquarters of a growing national company in its rural hometown, communities today recognize that their hopes for the future are tied to higher education. So the book really talks about this issue that the future of our economies are tied to higher ed. It's not just about research and innovation, though. We talk about that because that's sort of, it's sexy and fun. It's about creating startups. But it is so much more than that. It's about local communities. It's about being an anchor tenant. It's about keeping them alive and thriving and surviving. So let's talk about Plattsburgh. Got two great higher education institutions here, SUNY Plattsburgh, Clinton Community College. And in the book, we talk about this idea. Let's imagine if a giant laser beam appeared in the sky. You got to suspend your sort of understanding of science. And just zapped every part of higher ed, every part of Clinton, and every part of Plattsburgh. Just took them out, sucked them out, and put them somewhere else. What would be left? That's the question. If we think about the value of a college or university, we got to think about what happens when they're gone. Well, the first question we would raise is, where do those students go? It's a big part of it, right? College and universities bring students here, or they keep them here. One of the biggest things rural communities face today is brain drain, because it's very difficult to keep young people in small towns and small rural communities because they don't have the businesses, maybe they don't have the fun and exciting life that they might otherwise want. They want to go somewhere else. Well, we know if you go to college or university in a town, you're more likely to stay there. So for Plattsburgh, the fact that you have Plattsburgh, SUNY Plattsburgh and Clinton Community College here is not just an important factor in terms of attracting people from other parts of the region, but it's a critical part for keeping your young people here. It provides them an opportunity to go to college, to get a job, raise their family. And if they raise their family here, then hopefully their children will raise their family here. Because once you lose a young person, you lose that whole generation of family going forward. And it's incredibly difficult to get them back. So we think about the fact that we have students here, but students are people. They're families. They're moms and their dads. They are leaders of our communities and their mayors. They turn into something else. And if we can provide a way to keep them here, which is the college or university, that's absolutely critical for the success of Plattsburgh. They're a college-educated workforce, right? These are folks who are becoming leaders of their communities. They are pursuing jobs that are highly technical or highly engaged or require a high level of critical thinking. College-educated workforces also attract companies. Zaworski's here because they know they've got a college-educated workforce that they can draw on. And a lot of that's being educated by Plattsburgh and by Clinton Community College. You would lose that without them. Where would they go? And just to give you an example of what's going on right now in Plattsburgh, this is what the state says are the labor projections for the North Country. Right? Personal care aides are the biggest growth area. Structural metal fabricators and fitters, software developers and applications. Veterinary technologists, technicians, database administrators, architects, except for landscapers and naval, let's get technical. But the idea is most of these jobs require some form of college education. You need people coming through the workforce to be able to fill the jobs of the future. And we hope, because of programs, like Ken just talked about, Startup New York, creating new jobs that can be filled down the road. But not forget about the faculty and staff. I can put that up there because I'm a professor, so I can make fun of ourselves. We're a little kooky sometimes. People wonder what we do. We say funny things. We look kind of funny from time to time. But we're more than that, too, right? We are consumers. We buy things. We go to the store. We go downtown and we consume food. We keep local restaurants alive, us and the students and everybody else. We sleep, right? We rent apartments. We buy houses. And everything else we do. We go to Price Chopper. We go to Wilson Farms. We go to Cumberland 10. I try to look for some local pictures. But many of these businesses would not likely be able to survive. It would be much more struggling if you didn't have the students here, if you didn't have the faculty here, and you didn't have the staff here that are working at Clinton and Plattsburgh day in and day out. But more than that, all right, they're good employers. We know that. That's great. They themselves are a huge consumer of goods and products. They bring new revenue into Plattsburgh. Money that comes from the state government to help support the operations of the university itself. Tuition and fees that students pay. Discretionary money that comes in here that they are spending to get their college education. And grants and loans and other forms of revenue that's being raised, fundraising and those sorts of things. These are all, it's new money, largely, coming in to this community, which then is being spent. We're spending it at on the people, on the workforce. We're spending it on new construction projects. We're spending it on goods and services. We're spending it in local distributors. We're spending it in all sorts of ways that would not be spent otherwise if we didn't have the university here to bring the money in and spend it. We often forget about this, and I think this is a critical part, because it's not about economic development in the way that we think about bringing in new jobs. But if you think about the people who have really been talking about economic development, and particularly in downtowns and revitalizing cities, and I think about Richard Florida in particular, where he talks about the creative class and bringing in people that are entrepreneurs who have discretionary money. It's about being not just where you have a college-educated workforce, but it's about being where you have a really great place to live. It's about community vitality. It's about quality of life. It's about tolerance and understanding. College and universities bring something to communities that is often intangible in this sense. They bring young people in. They bring in activities. They put on performing arts. They bring in plays. They bring in speakers. They bring in sporting events that become part of the vital fabric of a community that make it worth living here, that make it exciting to be here. The Adirondacks have a lot to offer, a lot of tourism, but there's a lot going on in this community that is being driven by the college and university because they are about fostering quality of life. The students are about creating new opportunities and new experiences. And when you have that, you're more likely to get companies here because companies want to be somewhere where there is great quality of life because people want to live where there's great quality of life. And so when you have a great college town that has a great quality of life, which is largely being driven by the college, you're more likely to get business and universities, or to get business and industry to locate in that location. But it's also about supporting business development, right? We think about research and innovation. We think about the fact that new knowledge can create new jobs. But business and colleges and universities can also help existing businesses be better. How do they do that? Well, we can provide internships for students who have just learned the cutting edge in the classroom to go into the workforce and to share that knowledge and take it out there. We can create contract classes that are directly geared toward educating a specific workforce skill. that a manufacturer might need that they themselves cannot provide or maybe too expensive for them to provide. But they'll work with the college or university to set up a particular class or set of classes to help that their workforce develop the skills they need for that manufacturer to be successful. They're a job creator. We talk about this a lot today. Startup New York is about job creation, so we can't ignore that fact. And I put up here, there's a picture of Montreal. The winter's coming. Unfortunately, the leaves are changing. But Montreal, I think, is a great example of what's happening here, of ways in which college and universities help foster economic development, because being on the cusp of Canada, right here, you're an entryway into the U.S. And I was excited to learn about this a couple of weeks ago when I was up here, this idea that Plattsburgh is a suburb of Montreal. And I've been talking about it now, by the way. I've been telling people about it. I think it's kind of a cool idea. Because we often think very domestically wherever we are. And we don't think internationally. I lived in Grand Forks, North Dakota, by the way, which is another border town. Out in Grand Forks, Winnipeg, close to Winnipeg, Canada. It's amazing how far Canada seemed to be. Even though I could drive a half an hour and be across the border, I think for so many of our border towns, that happens. And it's great when a town can actually embrace the fact that it's part of a global community and realize that economic flow happens across international borders as well as across state borders. And so part of that flow, though, is happens because of colleges and universities. You've got two great institutions here. So when people in Montreal are looking into the U.S., you see a pipeline down into the United States and a great port right here with two universities that have a college-educated workforce, a quality of life that is being driven by your college and universities. And they say, when we want to come to the U.S., we want to be close to Canada, but we want to be someplace that's exciting. So they locate here. I would wager if SUNY Plattsburgh and Clinton Community College weren't here, it would not be as competitive in terms of attracting people from Canada. And I'm excited to be in a place that is really thinking globally, because we are truly in an era of global economic development and global competition. All right. I'm done with the book now. I'm not done with the book. The book is there. The book is pretty dense, and we go through a lot of really great ideas, I think, in terms of economic development. But I want to make it local, because this is really about trying to understand what happens here in Plattsburgh, here in the North Country. So I'm going to play a little Jeopardy game, and then I'm going to be done, and you're going to hear from everybody else talking about the great things happening in Plattsburgh. 12. What is that? Any idea? It relates to economic development. I hear silence, so I know you're not clear of the answer. That is, $12 million is the amount of taxes generated every year by public universities in the North Country. We think of these as tax-free entities, but they themselves are generating $12 million in tax revenue back into the local base here in the North Country. 6,700. You know my trend now, so any ideas? More than that. Number of jobs created by public universities in North Country. And I'm only talking public universities because that's the report I have, is that we did the power of SUNY. So this does not include all the independent colleges that are spread across the North Country as well. But this is the number of direct employment and indirect employment generated by the college and universities that are spread across the North Country. Somebody already answered this one. This is the number of students. 22,300 students are here in the North Country because of the SUNY schools that are here. And again, not counting Clarkson and St. Lawrence and everybody else. And they're not just from here. I think this is an important map to throw up because it shows you where the students are coming from. A lot of them are from the North Country, right? So we know that we are keeping a lot of those young people here, and we're providing educational opportunities for folks in the North Country. But a lot of them come from Albany, a few from out sort of along the western border out there. But look how many are coming up from New York City. There's a pretty good number coming up from New York City. Those people would likely not be here were it not for the college universities that are in the North Country. So we're drawing new population base into this region who we hope will then stay and be part of these wonderful communities that are here. 61,000. There's a trend here. We keep going up. It's the number of alumni, SUNY alumni who live in the North Country, who have stayed or have relocated here to be part of the communities, who are economic leaders, who are political leaders, who are helping drive the economy and the communities of North State. And the big number, 357 million. That's the amount of economic development in 1 year that SUNY schools contribute just to the North Country. The number is about a third higher if you're thinking about the total economic development or contributions to the entire state. So these are just the SUNY schools, the six or seven of them, that are up in this region, including SUNY Plattsburgh and Clinton Community College. It's how much economic development in 1 year is being contributed to the economies of this region. Imagine if that laser beam hit all six or seven of those SUNY schools and zapped them out of existence. What would happen to the communities up here? It'd be pretty devastating to think about it. So final Jeopardy, it's a fun one. Who's the job creator of today? Is it Michael Douglas in greed, cutting deals, building businesses, or is it the college and universities that are educating the doctors, the engineers, the journalists, the teachers, the pilots? I would wager it's the latter, because those are the ones who are out there thinking about what the next generation of job creation is going to be. They're the ones who are going to be the entrepreneurs that are creating new businesses. They're the ones who are actively part of our communities and driving change. But it's not about being an ivory tower. And I think that is the most critical part of this whole thing, and that was being driven home by Ken Earlier. Too long, universities have been thinking about what can the state do for us? And the question should be, what can universities do for the state? Because particularly for our SUNY schools, they were chartered and funded to serve the state. They're here to serve the citizens of the state, not just in terms of providing a college education, but in so much more. And we can't do that alone. It has to be the university working hand in hand with businesses and with the support of government through financial incentives and the appropriate policy mechanisms to make it happen. This book came out, we started the research for this book 2 years before Startup New York happened. All right, this book is not a promotional material for Startup. We started it long before that. But I'm excited to stand here and say I think Startup is a great example of what this country needs, because the governor actually recognizes that if you put the right policy mechanisms in place, we can more fully utilize our college and universities to help be the economic drivers of the communities across the state, which then in turn help drive the economic vitality of New York and its competitiveness domestically and globally. But even more importantly, it's about all the people behind the scenes. And I've got to say, for as famous as Gary Douglas is, it's incredibly hard to find a headshot of the man. Seriously, it's really tough. So I will leave it at that. It's been great to be here. I look forward to the conversation. My job was to sort of lay the table and get you thinking creatively about the ways universities contribute to economic development. It's their job to tell you what's happening on the ground and how it's actually happening today in Plattsburgh. Thank you.
Two mics that you'll see here at the end of the aisle, so please, if you have questions, we'll have a few moments for you to ask those. Right now, it's my honor. I'd like to introduce the panelists to come in and take part and further this discussion. I will introduce everyone so that we get them in the correct seat. Paul Grasso is the president and CEO of the Development Corporation here in Plattsburgh. Gary Douglas is the president of the North Country Chamber of Commerce. John Jablonski needs no introduction, the president of Clinton Community College. Dr. John Etling is the president of SUNY Plattsburgh. Leanne Prey is the head of human resources at Swarovski Worldwide Lighting, also many folks very familiar with the Schoenbeck family for many years here in the Plattsburgh area. And Jason Lane is sitting in with us as well. Welcome, everyone. While you get situated, I thought the best place to start was to pick up on Jason's presentation. Some of the highlights from that, some of your thoughts, some of the maybe numbers that he threw out there at the end. Any of that surprising, or is this something that you folks knew all about and are sharing with us here tonight? Let's hear some of your thoughts on some of the points he raised in his presentation.
I was struck by the notion of the contribution of people, which we don't think of in terms of impact, but it's very important, and particularly to this community, as I thought about it. The greatest loss of the closure of Plattsburgh Air Force Base in 1995 wasn't economic. We actually recovered from that fairly quickly, thanks to some of the things that have been mentioned. It really was the loss of people. We had become a great beneficiary of that. Every 2 years, people from all over the country coming to serve here at an Air Force base with their families, and communities that did a good job and those that continue to do a good job of hosting a military base will get more than their share of those folks coming back and becoming part of the community. That was a huge human loss to this community, which only now makes even more important the colleges as the kind of the remaining opportunity that still brings people in here. And it was a reminder that it's important that we think about that and make sure that we're maximizing that potential to convert those students in the future into returnees like the Air Force people used to be.
I would add to that I think it's also the place where you see the most cultural diversity in the community. It's not just the people, it's the diversity that colleges bring to the area.
Well, let's talk about our universities and colleges here in the North Country, in particular, SUNY Plattsburgh and Clinton Community College. Dr. Etling, President Jablonski, is this more than a vision as we talk about now colleges, universities as economic drivers? Is it more than a vision, or are your institutions already playing major roles in the economic vitality of our region?
I would say it's both. The SUNY Plattsburgh has been a part of this community since 1889, and since then we've been providing much of the professional infrastructure for Clinton County and for the city of Plattsburgh. We've been educating and turning out into the public schools teachers, administrators, more recently nurses, accountants, corrections officers, healthcare workers. It's, as I say, we've been contributing that kind of intellectual and professional infrastructure for 120-something years. But it's also a vision, because I think there's more that we can do without departing from the mission that sustained us for over the century and a quarter that we've been here. But that's what's exciting about looking forward to the future and taking advantage of things like Startup New York.
John's right. It's a work in progress. The obvious thing, I think, for most people in the community is what we do in the way of workforce development, especially through our degree and certificate programs. What might not be as obvious is how we're supporting business and industry and economic growth in ways that, maybe happen outside the classroom or on the fringes of the classroom. I'll give one example. Here at Clinton Community College, we have I'll call it a department, better known as CCWD. It's the Center for Community and Workforce Development. It's a place, for example, that we deliver directly to business and industry just in time, either training or educational opportunities that don't necessarily lead to a college certificate or a college degree, but it's skill building, it's training, it's what NovaBus needs when it's going through its expansion, it's what Bombardier needs when a new line is coming up. It's what Swarovski calls on us to do to help make sure that their workforce is productive. So I think it's a work in progress. We've always done sort of the degree and certificate things that serve the workforce, but not everybody knows about the things that sort of happen behind the curtain.
You're right, and as Jason pointed out, there is the economic impact that people probably suspect. You have thousands of students, thousands of faculty here. They, of course, have an impact on the community and the economy, but what you just talked about, do you see your roles expanding in that regard as being the drivers of economic growth by being able to help companies do the things like you just mentioned?
Yes. And I'll tell you, you know, I'm going to borrow a phrase that Gary Douglas taught me, and every time I say it, I think you know, fondly of the lesson that Gary taught me. If you're a small institution, if you're a small community, and you want to punch above your weight, find something that's bigger and figure out how you can make an important contribution to it. So I'll tell you a couple of examples, and John may want to chime in on this. A few years ago, just after Kelly and our daughters and I arrived in the community, there was this thing happening called Vision 2040. It happened largely because of one of the professors at SUNY Plattsburgh, but it engaged the whole community in something that was bigger than just the university or the community college. And so Clinton, with its new president at the time, and a number of people from both of our institutions, sort of said, hey, we can make not only a contribution, we can make a leading contribution to this community-wide effort. And that, to me, is exciting. It took us outside or beyond what we ordinarily thought of ourselves as, and it really put us in the seat of the driver.
Gary, you are the expert on this. No one is more aware of how much our economy here in this part of the North Country is dependent on our cross-border trade with Canada. How critical is Quebec, and in particular, the Montreal area, to our economic vitality?
It's everything. We are Montreal's U.S. suburb. I mean, that was a vision that the Chamber set out for this region 15 years ago, and it was thought to be a 20-year effort. And I think we see success when we see so many people voicing back to us now what we've been saying for 15 years. That means that paradigm shift in thinking and perspective is sinking in within the area and also outside of the area. And I want to cite that part of the genesis of that was very much the Canadian Studies Program at SUNY Plattsburgh. Gene Kistner and Richard Beach, who were really highlighting the opportunities to build partnerships and relationships and bringing people down, were part of what was then our Canadian Connection Committee, which just kind of made us all start to realize where the opportunity was. I mean, today we conservatively estimate the Chamber that the annual direct, no multipliers, no extrapolations, direct economic impact of our cross-border relationship with Canada in all of its many forms, including things like Mountain Lake Public Broadcasting, exceeds $2 billion a year just on Clinton County. 85,000 people, $2 billion a year. And that doubled over the last 15 years. So it's huge, it's dynamic, it's the business we're in, and it's a good business to be in.
And some of the other numbers that we hear, 15% of the employees in Clinton County?
We estimate 15% of the workforce in Clinton County got up this morning, went to work for a Canadian or border-related employer in the county.
And we know the major players. We know Nova Bus, Jim Tooley's company. We know Bombardier. But we have nearly 200 Canadian companies that have a presence in Clinton County.
We have a list at the Chamber of 186 Quebec-based businesses in Clinton County or the immediate Clinton County area, most of which people aren't even aware of. Some of them are even retail operations they don't know have Canadian owners, but have some kind of physical presence there.
Many of them provide services for some of the larger Canadian companies here.
And that's growing, and the opportunity, you know, as Paul will confirm, we're on the cusp right now of a new wave of very active interest in Canadian investment in the U.S., and when there's that wave, we're going to get our share, because not just where we are, but we're good at getting our share out of it. It's here, it's cresting, we're going to be benefiting from it over the next 2 years. The teamwork that we have with our colleges is critical to that, because we can sit here and say we've got great facilities, we've got a great location, the border works good. Sooner or later, when you're a little community of 40,000 people, the question comes, well, that all sounds good, but you want to explain to me how you're going to meet my workforce needs? And we have the answers.
Paul, if you could share with us what you can about to...
You know, and that's really the first question. You know, Gary and I are working more closely together. We're both bringing...
We are now. He's got the socks.
Yeah.
But small steps, we'll get you there.
Wait till you see those socks in HD on television.
It's the first question we're asked when we're in Canada. You know, I mean, I think the incentives come down the line. It's, you know, we believe you can provide our workforce for today, but what are your seventh graders taking? What are your eighth graders? How many are graduating? What are they doing? How many are staying? Those are the issues that we hear when we're up in Canada. At TDC, we have an initiative. It's a business retention and expansion program. I mean, everybody talks about the allure of attracting the new business that comes here. It gets all the headlines, but your real growth comes from the businesses that are already here. We have within our park a tremendous amount of expansion. And we have a survey. We do it a couple of times a year. And one of the questions that we ask the employers is, you know, how would you rate your workforce? And it really breaks out into two areas. The employers that pay a livable wage and have benefits are very pleased with the workforce. They find them to be very productive, very loyal, very hardworking. As a matter of fact, Fujitsu moved their entire manufacturing operation here to Plattsburgh based on the workforce. Then there are the others that, they don't show up, just the turnover, all the myriad of things that you hear. But when you really whittle it away, it's, you know, they're paying lower wages and no benefits. And the turnovers would be because they're going to companies that have benefits. One of the blessings that we have is we have two university presidents that work within some very constraining systems to be able to offer the programs that employers need. It takes years to get curriculum through state education department. We were having a meeting earlier today and somebody referred to them as sluggish, and I said they actually aspire to be sluggish. It would be a part of continuous improvement. But they both work within that system to be able to offer the trainings and the courses that people without having to go through that that horrific approval system. And the private colleges just don't have that issue. So we're blessed to have them.
When the Canadian companies approach you, do you tell them that you have the workers that they already need with the skills that they already need, or that they can be trained to have the skills that they need?
We tell them both. I mean, the two things that the Chamber and TDC do very well, it's a very customized approach. This isn't a one-size-fits-all. So we ask about their corporate cultures. We ask about their, the job descriptions. What do they consider a qualified widget maker? And then we work to make sure that we can provide those people. We never say no.
Well, and it's very much a team approach. We're famous for what we call our red carpet programs. When we have a company, sometimes we go to them, we try to get them to come down here. It's a team approach. A lot of areas, they do economic development. They got one of Paul's colleagues, I got some sites to show you. And that's kind of the end of it. Maybe Empire State Development talks about some incentive programs. But we bring the whole team together and we say, we're going to take you by the hand, Canadian business, and we're going to cover everything that makes you successful here. And we have these folks from the schools and from CV Tech as well, which needs mentioning here as a key partner in our area. They're at the table. When it's appropriate, there's going to be workforce questions. They're around the table with us. There's that degree of trust and partnership in terms of development here.
And John, you mentioned if it's not part of the curriculum, you have the flexibility to customize programs, non-credit programs possibly, to help these businesses find the workers that they need.
We do. And some of those are recurring programs. Computer applications, for example, we can reproduce that over and over again because we're called on over and over again. Some of it is highly specialized that it's once and done. But the nice thing is, because to a certain degree anyway, this is a college town, our CCWD, that Center for Community and Workforce Development, can call on the faculty that is SUNY Plattsburgh. They can call on the faculty that is here at Clinton Community College. They can call on the experts that we have in the Chamber and the Development Corporation. And in effect, we become the clearinghouse. We become the broker of that once and done, customized, just what you need, just when you need it, workforce development training.
Nova was a perfect example.
It was a great example when, three years ago, I guess, Nova expanded its production line. It was in excess of 100 new employees that were being hired, needed to ramp up quickly, and Clinton Community College was there. It wasn't something we had in the can, but we were nimble, despite some of the constraints that Paul talked about. And yes, we delivered, and here we are, with a thriving organization that proudly we can say we helped them in that growth.
Which in turn created the confidence for Prevo to follow. You did such a good job for us on that first facility, the other branch of our company is confident you'll do well by us too.
So Jim, we're ready.
One of the things we're working on, Thom, is an advanced manufacturing institute. TDC and the foundation have jointly funded a study to begin to look at what is it that employers moving into the area or here are going to need in terms of advanced manufacturing skills, which is a really broad term. You know, I always say for Tony Collins it means robotics, and for some other companies it means precision measurement and the ability to use some tools. So we're always trying to stay a little bit ahead of the demand.
And for some companies it means trade schools. Exactly. It means training workers who may not necessarily be going on. They may go to Clinton Community for 2 years, but for others it may be instant training right out of high school.
Exactly.
Dr. Ettling, let me go back. Gary mentioned the Center for the Study of Canada, also the Institute of Quebec Studies, the role that they play in bringing together business and community leaders, connecting businesses with potential employers, connecting them with students. How critical is that for the university to have that here, and how well is that working in connecting students with businesses?
Now, let me start with the first part of your question. I think in working with the chamber over the years that I've been here, the 10 or so, we have been able to keep Plattsburgh on the radar of the political classes in Ottawa and in Quebec City. We bring every ambassador from the United States to Canada down here, provide a bully pulpit, introduce them to the business community. Likewise, Canadian ambassadors in Washington also put an appearance here, spend a day or so. Foreign Affairs Canada helps fund some of the programs that we have in place through the center. And so has the Delegate General from Quebec in Manhattan. I rue the day when the Canadian government decided to close the consulate in Buffalo because we had terrific relationship with them. We're funded also through the Canada-US Fulbright Foundation to house a scholar in residence from Canada. We send our students to study for a semester or more at Canadian universities, invite Canadian students here. There's another part to that relationship, and that's the fact that we, about 5 or 6 years ago, created an undergraduate degree program in supply chain management specifically because of our location here on the Canadian border. Gary says where goods move, that's where prosperity occurs. Much of PARC was, and nobody saw this coming, are Canadian companies moving things in bulk across the border, storing them here, and providing them just-in-time delivery to customers out there in the lower 48, as they used to call it. I just couldn't help but notice that slide that Jason had of the kids sitting on the stairs saying, where have the students gone? One of the students in that picture was a supply chain management major who graduated last year. She had worked with UPS in London during the London Olympics, and she was offered a job 3 or 4 months before she graduated, starting salary of $60,000 and moving expenses. Unfortunately, it's at IBM across the lake, but nevertheless, supply chain management makes good sense for us. Our internships and mentoring programs aren't limited to those two obvious programs. We have, I asked Mary Carpenter today, who runs our internship program in the business school, and last year she placed 170 interns in local businesses, as well as 47 students who were paired with local business leaders through the School of Business's mentoring program. A couple of years ago, this is just an anecdote, I was coming out of a Chamber of Commerce board meeting early in the morning, and John Cooper, who was then president, CEO of Champlain National Bank, stopped me and said that, this was in September, I guess, as he just had a SUNY Plattsburgh intern through the summer who, in August, before he left, sat down with Mr. Cooper and pointed out a way he could save $30,000 a year. And John said he more than paid for himself. Yeah.
So John mentioned a few of the things that are, I think, really outstanding at SUNY Plattsburgh with the internship program and that mentoring program that Mary Carpenter and others are working on. And the interesting variant I wanted to say about that is here at Clinton, with our partners, we've developed a couple of these, you know, again, non-credit but very relevant programs. One is called AIME, Assembly industry, manufacturing, education, and another one is the National Work Readiness Credential, and some members of our audience were instrumental in developing that. We have a business advisory council here. But all of that is the setup to say that these are good examples of how students develop not only the hard skills, the technical skills, but the soft skills that then set them up for employment opportunities that they may not have had before. How to interview for a job, how to connect with those employers, and so on. And some of the employees, some of the employers, rather, that are here tonight have been great consumers of the people that have come through those programs as well. So yes, on the credit side, we have those built-in academic internships and mentoring programs, but we're all also doing those things on the side that serve the other audience.
And Leanne?
I have 15 staff at the chamber. Two of them right now came to me as interns from SUNY. We hired.
Is that right? Yeah.
Two out of 15.
So and they're not just spending a summer.
They're building careers. It can lead directly to a job.
And speaking of that, Leanne, this is a great place to bring you into the conversation. You've had a number of interns from Plattsburgh State.
We have, actually, and we've been the beneficiary of a lot of the programs that we've been talking about up here. On average, we host probably 10 students a semester, and we've done so for a number of years now across all disciplines. So everything from supply chain to legal to accounting. So we have a number of students that come to visit us every semester, and we've had great success with the interns that we've received. They do a great job for us. It's allowed us to stay cutting edge, so we get as much benefit from them being with us as they do being with us. They're amazing in what they've been able to accomplish with us. We've set up an extension of the classroom in our facility for them, so they get the learning environment in the real world, and it's just fabulous. So they leave us, they go on to other internships, they go on to graduate school, they go on to the real world, the workforce, and we've had the great fortune of having a number of them come back to us. They want to come back to this area, they remember their internship and their time with us, they give us a call and we welcome them back with open arms.
For an international company based in Plattsburgh, that must be nice to be able to hire local hires.
We really are a gateway for them to the rest of the world. We have 28,000 employees all around the world, and if they're successful with us, they can go anywhere.
Leanne, I don't think to toot her own horn, but it's the model internship program. If any private sector company is interested in starting an internship program, that's the one they should model it on. It's competitive, and there's a lot of rigor in what they do, and I think the students benefit a lot from it, and it's just a great program, and we're proud that they're in our park.
Thank you.
Ken Adams certainly touched on the subject. Governor Cuomo's startup plan that he came here to Plattsburgh to promote back in May, we're used to hearing about offering tax breaks to encourage business and economic growth, research and development in so-called tax-free zones. But is the governor's plan that ties those tax breaks to colleges and universities across New York something new? Do you think it could succeed in attracting new businesses to New York, lure startup companies to work on innovation, to develop new products with our universities? Do you think this has great potential?
I certainly do. We've already gotten inquiries. I can't talk about it. Omerta. Gary has sworn
that's
me to.
That's the follow-up question coming in here.
We've talked too.
Yeah, okay. But yeah, I'm excited. Right now we're waiting to see what the rules are of the road in this instance, but we're putting together a business plan that will, I'm sure, will accommodate it to whatever the rules end up being. But yeah, we have been getting inquiries.
All right, the journalist has to press a little. Share with us what you can. How many inquiries or how serious have the inquiries been? And have a majority of them been coming from
Canada? Well, there's three serious ones that I'm aware of at the chamber that we've discussed with both of these gentlemen, just to kind of get them on the radar scope. And we've discussed with the state, with Ken's colleagues, and at SUNY, as they put together the rules and regulations, we've kind of helped and had the opportunity to help kind of feed in some things we think are possibilities here, you know, and look to avoid unintentional barriers that might pop up when rules are made sometimes that would confound something. So there's been a good dialogue in that regard that gives me reason to think that what comes out here in terms of the process will be something that's workable.
The exciting thing, and again, I won't mention names here, but the exciting thing is the conversation as it's been framed has mutual benefits. The benefits to the company that's expanding or relocating here are probably obvious. But that partnership that Ken talked about, that it has to be related in some way to the curriculum here, to the program, or the research that's going on at some of the other universities, has benefits to the college or the university as well. So often these days we find ourselves constrained, and the taxpayers, the general public, finds itself constrained to support all of the things that we would do here. Public-private partnership is a way to bring in those supplemental revenues, leverage those assets that go beyond what's in the public sector.
And there are, you know, understandable concerns that were expressed from the start, particularly from existing business. Oh, some competitor is going to have an unfair advantage over me because I'm paying all these taxes and they're going to be exempted. But I think if we use it well, and I know this area will use it well, those won't be the kinds of situations that folks will see arising. They will be examples of new investment coming in and doing something that may well not have happened in the community at all, and doing something that's not competitive, in fact, is providing business to a lot of those folks that would be concerned about that unfair competition. And the defining difference in the benefits that is causing excitement, and I think if we use well, will be powerful, and we will use it well, isn't the property tax exemption. IDAs have always been capable of doing that or doing pilots. It isn't the corporate tax exemption. There have always been empire zones and different things in the past that have, you know, provided some breaks there. It's the exemption of the employees from personal income tax. Now, why is that important? Not as a giveaway, but because if you're a company, particularly a company at the high end, who's looking at a place like Plattsburgh, that little community of 40,000 people, and you want to create, you know, several hundred jobs, you're going to have to recruit from out of the area, and you're going to have everything you can provide to recruit that talent, and then to have the confidence that you'll retain that talent and not lose it. And that there's a real sticky factor to that that is powerful if we use it right.
Is that a new tool?
Yes, absolutely a new tool.
And is that a game changer?
It's a game changer.
When the governor was here speaking, Ken, maybe, I don't remember the numbers, but they were pretty astounding, about the amount of innovation that occurs in New York that gets drawn away by some other state offering some tax incentives. And so you started here, it's innovated, you started here, and it grows somewhere else. And that's the area where that creates, you know, all the benefits or accrues all the benefits. And I think that will be also an important thing for statewide to keep businesses that start here, keep them here.
And the state is also at the same time promoting innovation, incubator sites, trying to get some of that going on the college campuses here in the North Country, especially at Clarkson University.
Because that's true economic development. When something can start here and you can sell your product elsewhere and bring that money into the region, that's what really benefits the region.
All right, folks, get your question ready. We'll be turning to you in just a moment. Let's ask one last question. How better could our political leaders, our local and state governments, our businesses, our higher education all collaborate to develop public policies to guide or even boost economic contributions that come from our colleges and universities?
So you really want to end on a high note.
I'll throw it out to anyone. Is there?
I think our political leaders are doing exactly what they need to do. I mean, at the congressional level, I don't think rural areas anywhere in the country have a congressman more in tune with what needs to be done in rural areas than we have in Congressman Owens. I think we have a strong delegation in Albany that does what it can for our region, given the fact that, you know, they're in the minority party most of the time. And I think locally, the mayor and the town supervisors, I think they do, you know, as much as they can. I think they're supportive where they need to be. I think more importantly, they rarely seem to get in the way, which sometimes is the most you can hope for with elected officials.
With the economic times, though, and there are tough economic times, and there has to be budgets cut, with Plattsburgh and Clinton community being on the receiving end of those cuts, is that short-sighted? Are you taking away resources that these colleges need to create these programs, to do exactly what you're talking about here tonight? Is that a danger to talk about budget cuts for the university?
I think there's a danger at some point if you were to carry things too far. I don't think there's been a danger to date. I think there's been a reality kind of confronted, and this governor has helped us do that. We had to change our thinking. There aren't limitless resources. Albany the cupboard is kind of bare. They can't kind of run to the rescue, and there's some pain for a period of time in adjusting to that. But you know, my own belief is that everything that's been done over the last couple of years, in terms of controlling spending and capping spending and property tax caps and so on, has been reasonable, requires some painful adjustment. We're getting to that adjustment, and now can go forward, and I think ultimately start to see growth in revenues again, because we're doing the right things to position the state so revenues can come from growth. Revenues don't just appear. You can't just spend and spend and spend. You have to create prosperity and growth, and when we do that, there'll be more revenue for everybody.
And Jason, let me end with you. You during your presentation, you talked about some of those communities. You gave examples from that book of communities in Massachusetts, North Carolina, Nebraska that recognize it, as you mentioned, that their hopes for the future are tied to higher education. What can we learn from them?
You know, I think
what they're doing.
The biggest thing is realizing that these entities are incredibly important resources that have a lot to give to the communities. That's more than what we typically think about, and that's the education of students, which is incredibly important. More than that, I think it's the fact that these universities and colleges in those communities came to recognize that they had resources that could help support the communities that they were in. And they helped. What really happened was a transformation of the dialogue. And that oftentimes we see a dialogue that is antagonistic, where the university is looking for money and the government saying, you cost us so much money, you're a drain on our budget. And it's about those communities came together and say, you know what, we need to work together to make this place better, to make it successful, because there are resources that when put together can be so much more powerful than when they're fighting with each other. And I think what's incredibly important about what's happening right now with startup and what we see here in Plattsburgh and what we see in New York State is that we have a great opportunity for the leader of the SUNY system, Nancy Zinfer, and the leader of the state, Andrew Cuomo, to come together and say, how do we make the resources of these two great entities work together to benefit the state of New York? We've not had that for a while. And that's powerful when you start rowing in the same direction. Because Nancy has said, what is it that SUNY can do for the state? And then the governor has turned to the system and said, you know, how can you help us move forward and regain the economic vitality that we had prior to 2008? And collectively, that's happening at the state level, and I think we're seeing it trickling down here. The conversation that's happened at this panel is a great example of our business leaders and our academic leaders coming together to say, let's work together, let's make it happen, we're all in it, you know, for the same cause. And that's what's happening in those communities, and that's what I'm seeing happening in New York State, which is incredibly exciting.
Thank you. I'd like to open it up to the audience. If audience members have any questions, please come right up to one of the mics. You can also talk to all the panelists, of course, during the reception and the dinner after, if you'd like to have a one-on-one conversation. While we're waiting for that, panelists, final thoughts?
We were, Paul and I and several others were at a meeting today, and a phrase came up that I've heard more in the last year than I probably have ever before in my life, and it's the phrase, collective impact. We've used it in this organization, this Cradle Through Career organization that aims to increase educational attainment in our community. And it's a long-range goal. But the idea of collective impact in that arena and in the arena that we are in with this panel is the idea that each of us working independently of the other can accomplish a certain amount of success. But when we do what we are doing here, and I suggest what may be happening elsewhere in New York State, our efforts are multiplied. It's not simply the sum of our efforts, the amount that we accomplish through that collective impact is not additional. It's multiplicative. And I don't know about every place in New York, but the ones that I've seen don't hold a candle to how our collective impact in Plattsburgh is really having that multiplicative effect.
And that's true. We talk about companies and investors that we deal with, particularly from Canada. They're always blown away by the teamwork. They just, we bring them in a room and all 12 are sitting around the table at the same time, covering everything, including a workforce and those elements, and they're blown away from that. Everybody says they have teamwork. We actually have it.
Yeah, we do have to work together, and I think we've got a head start on other regions, perhaps, because we realize that we will die if we don't. I mean, John and I have served on Gary's board, serve on Gary's board, on Paul's as well. It's something that we do. How do you get Senator Schumer to return your phone calls? You build a chamber that has over 4,000 members. In the North Country, forget it. I mean, how many members are in the Buffalo Chamber? Over 4,000?
About the same.
About the same. That's how you do it.
Clout. Great. Thank you. John, thank you for hosting here at Clinton Community College. We appreciate it. Once again, Jason, thank you for coming up. Your presentation tonight, Jason's book, is out in the lobby, and he is also staying for the reception. We'll be happy to talk to you. Ken Adams, thank you very much for your words and coming up from Albany. We appreciate it. Bob Bullock, thank you for organizing this from the Rockefeller Institute. The next forum, if you would like to drive, will be October 7th in Clarkson at Clarkson University, I believe, in the afternoon, and if you would like to attend that. And thank you for coming tonight. We appreciate it, and enjoy the reception.